I'd like to call the Roseville City Council meeting for December 18, 2012 to order. May we please rise and pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Based on notifications that I received this evening, Councilman Switalski, Mayor Pro Tem Taylor, and Councilwoman Hagerty cannot attend tonight due to different reasons. So can I have a motion to excuse them, please?
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilman Aiuto. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. They are excused. Under routine matters, approval of minutes of regular meeting held November 27, 2012.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilman Shoemaker. Is there any questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request approval of minutes of special meeting held December 4, 2012.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Shoemaker, supported by Councilman Aiuto. Is there any questions on the minutes? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request approval of minutes of regular meeting held December 11, 2012.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney, supported by Councilman Shoemaker, to approve the minutes of December 11, 2012. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request approval of disbursement list.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Shoemaker, supported by Councilman Aiuto. Is there any questions on the disbursement list this evening? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is correspondence. Mr. Clerk, do we have any correspondence this evening?
Mayor, the only thing I would like to indicate tonight is that I just placed the 2013 city calendar that my office is providing in front of you, and they are available to the public for pickup. So anybody wishes to have a city calendar can come into my office, and we do have them ready for anybody that's willing to pick them up.
Okay. Thank you. Next item is first hearing of the public. Public comments on agenda items will be heard at this first hearing. Upon approaching the podium, please state your name and address. Address the chair. You're welcome to direct questions, input information, and express opinions to the council. Anyone using inappropriate language will be called out of order or correct their language or leave the podium. Limit your remarks not to exceed 3 minutes. Is there anybody who wished to be heard on agenda items only? Seeing none, we will move into new business. Presentation of audit for fiscal year ending June 30, 2012 by Plant Moran. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council. This evening, for purposes of presentation, I have a presentation from Plant Moran in regards to the fiscal year ended June 30, 2012. You have several documents that have been placed in front of you this evening in regards to the matter of this evening. And if there are no questions at this point, defer to the presentation for council this evening.
Any questions for Mr. Atkins before we get started? Seeing none. Mr. Hurst, you're on.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Happy holidays.
Same here.
My name is Mark Hurst, and I'm an audit partner with the governmental accounting firm of Plant and Moran. And I'm here tonight to present the results of the city's independent and external audits for the year ended June 30th, 2012. As the city manager has stated, council has a number of pieces of information in your packet tonight from Plant and Moran. And my first promise to you is that I will try to move through these briskly and diligently. These are your numbers. You've seen them before. I've told council in years past, and this year was no exception. The quality of the books and records that we come in and we audit for the city of Roseville are really excellent, outstanding. We have very few adjustments, if any. So you've seen these numbers before. They're just packaged a little bit differently. And so with that, let me point out some of the highlights in the financial information that you've received. The first item, I'll start with it because it's a pretty quick one. There's a separate audit of federal awards. It says federal awards supplemental information on the front. This is an audit of your federal program revenue that the city of Roseville receives. And so the good news is, first off, that you have this audit, because that means that federal dollars are coming in and they're being utilized within Roseville city limits, which is terrific. You only get this audit if you have more than $500,000 in federal revenue come into your community. And this particular audit, while it's partially financial, is mostly compliance-oriented. So these grants that you're accepting in have strings tied to them and provisions that you have to meet. We come in and make certain that all the provisions that are outlined in those grants are met. If we have any issues or problems that arise, those need to be noted. We had no findings as a result of any of the federal program audits that we did. And the total amount of federal revenue was $1.7 million this year that Roseville brought in. So moving ahead from there, your biggest report is your general purpose financial statement. That's the bound document, which is, I'm guessing, almost 100 pages long in total. Again, I'm not going to pull through this in great detail. As we've done in the past, we've prepared a very brief six-slide presentation with the financial highlights of some of the numbers that are in this document. What I'd really like to focus your attention in on now is the opinion letter from Plant and Moran. You don't have to search through and find it unless you want to. It's listed as page one, but it's probably about 7 or 8 pages into the financial document. It's a letter that's on Plant Moran's letterhead. And this is the main thing that you have retained our firm to provide. This is our opinion on this financial document based on, I want to say just for this document alone, 600 to 700 hours with the total audit time. So there's a lot of work that goes into this process on our end. And the good news is, after all of that work, I think we had maybe one minor adjustment, if any, and we were able to give the city an unqualified audit opinion. And an unqualified opinion is a clean opinion. It's the best opinion that we can give in a financial document, period. The reason I pointed out that we only had one minor adjustment was because we have communities, there's many of them that are going on right now, where we will have 50, 60 journal entries that we will make to get the books right. And if they agree with us, those communities too can receive an unqualified opinion. So not all unqualified opinions are the same. And so you have an unqualified opinion, but you also have outstanding books and records supporting the financial documents that we had reviewed. I'd be remiss at this point if I didn't also thank all of those from the city administration, your city manager. Of course, we have Bob Cady here tonight and Jane Dancy from the finance department. Those would be Jane and Bob would be the two individuals that we interact with most throughout the entire audit process. So I had said we spend about 600 hours on this document, maybe another 100 or 200 hours on federal awards work that we do. I know council is aware of the fact that because you have talented people in your finance department, that they have accepted the responsibility for doing accounting for a couple of the joint ventures that you're now involved with, Parks and Rec and Cerisa. Those have been additional workloads that have been put on top of their commitments that they previously had, and we perform those audits at the same time that we do Roseville's audits. So there has, to put it bluntly, there's been a lot of work going on, and I really appreciate everything that Jane Dancy in particular has done for us. We probably all together about 1,000 hours of audit time, and those are auditors that are lined up outside her door on a daily basis for well over a month, asking to see things, needing to see documents and support. And you know, Bob pitches in and helps out as well. It's a big undertaking. We don't take anything for granted. And again, you had outstanding results again this year. So we want to make certain that we recognize the effort that Jane in particular has put in to make certain that these results are delivered every year for the city of Roseville. With that, what I would like to do, I have one of my colleagues with me here this evening, and I should have mentioned her earlier, Kathleen Santar. Kathleen, if you want to stand up and say hi. Kathleen, in our world, is what we refer to as an audit in charge, which means that she has the day-to-day responsibility of overseeing our audit team and all the audit procedures that are performed by Plant and Moran. She is here on a daily basis as opposed to Carrie Shea, whom we've met in the past, who's our manager, who would be basically between Kathleen and I. And so with that, I'm going to turn it over to Kathleen, and she's going to run through a few of the pages in the graph presentation that we have for council.
Thank you. Hello, council.
Hello. Good evening.
All right, so I'm going to run through some of the slides here. Through the first. Hopefully it doesn't do anything crazy. All right, so you also have this packet in front of you. This first slide shows you your general fund, which is your main fund, the revenue that was earned over the past 3 years. So it's a comparison from 2010 on the left to 2012 on the right. The one thing you will notice is that over the past 3 years, your revenue has declined approximately $6 million at about $3 million a year. And that is directly attributable to your property tax revenue declining at about the same rate. So that's about an 8% decrease each year. You'll notice that the property tax revenue declined at the same rate, and that's directly attributable to your property tax values. So when I went back and looked at your millage rates for your general operating capture, they were at right about 20 mils each year. So it is directly attributable to those property tax values declining. If we go on to the next slide, this shows us the general fund revenue in a little bit of a different picture. Again, you'll see that property tax revenue is the biggest piece of that. The one thing that I would like to point out here is that really the only thing that you guys have control of would be the fines, fees, and licenses. So that's the smallest piece at 10%. That's the only thing that you can set your fees at, such as your building permits or your licenses. Everything else is kind of out of your control. So I think that's about it on this slide. And then if we go to the third slide, this is your general fund expenditures. And so this would be kind of comparable to that first slide we were looking at with 2010 on the left and 2012 on the right. The good news here is you'll see that your expenditures have declined as well. So we saw about $5.5 million decrease in expenditures from 2010 to 2012, which is offset by your decrease of $6 million in revenue. So it's good that your decrease in expenditures has kept pace, pretty much. The one thing that I would warn you against, though, is if you actually put these slides side by side, you'll notice that your expenditures are already greater than your revenue. So for 2010, your expenditures exceeded revenue by $2.6 million. 2011, expenditures exceeded revenue by $2 million. And 2012, expenditures exceeded revenue by $3 million. So this kind of puts you into a structural deficit. You're already using up your fund balance each year as your expenditures are exceeding the revenue you're bringing in. The two other small things on this slide that I would like you to note are that your public safety expenditures approximate 50 cents on the dollar for all of your costs out of the general fund. And lastly, that there is a couple expenditures in there. You'll notice that dotted line that make things a little uncomparable from year to year. So that would be like your pension costs, some of your grant expenditures. Mark had mentioned that you had $1.7 million in grant revenue. So you're going to have expenditures that are offsetting that, and that would be in that piece there. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mark, who's going to cover some more information on your property taxes.
Thanks, Kathleen. Next few slides will be the speed round, I promise. These next two slides in your packet, you've seen these before, and one of the reasons why we present these slides every year is a reminder, we know council's fully aware of this, I mean, really, this is more a reminder for the general public. You know, everything that we're going to talk about here in terms of your financial position, Roseville's financial position, is not unlike any other mature community in Michigan right now. It isn't. Everybody's basically in the same boat. The question is, how much have you been able to do to actually reduce expenses, and you probably had your most productive year, I think, to date, in terms of ultimately striking new contracts and making material adjustments to your expenditures going forward, which is terrific. But what led all of us, what led all these mature communities to this position is really two things. First off, this is just a brief graph of the changes in revenue sharing. Back in the day, which I was thinking about it, this graph starts in 2001. I can remember exactly where I was in 2001, so it doesn't seem like it was that long ago anymore. But in 2001, there was an expectation that revenue sharing from the state was going to continue to increase it at least an inflationary level for all local units of government. And if you'd have polled anybody who was in municipal finance at that time, we all would have said the same thing. Nobody would have ever imagined that the state would be making the sizable cuts that they have done to state shared revenue. So all of your benefits, all of your long-term legacy costs, all of those things contractually were all built on the assumption that these dollars were going to be here for you long-term. Well, come to find out, 2001, the state started adjusting downward statutory revenue sharing, the portion that they had control over. And what that means cumulatively, since 2001 when they started making the cuts, for the city of Roseville, it's roughly a $22 million decline in revenue. So you would have received $22 million more dollars if you had just stayed the same course that you were on, that we all would have predicted you would have been on, than what you have today. And again, that's in comparison to a $36 million annual fund balance. So it's two-thirds of 1 year's worth of operating expenses, not to mention the impact that could have had positively on all of your pensions and other fringe benefit obligations. Again, it's the same story for everybody, unfortunately, but I can tell you nobody saw that coming. The next slide in the packet is just a summary of property tax revenue. Again, frankly, another sneak attack, which if any of us could have predicted this, we probably all would have sold our homes in 2007 and become renters. But in 2008, there was a significant decline in the property values. And when those property values declined, the property tax revenue that was generated as a result of that declined as well. So we have two lines on this graph. The line that was shooting up was your property tax revenue actual for 2007, and then what it would have been assuming you would have just had inflationary level increases in property values. So 2007, you were at $29 million in property tax revenue. If you had been just maintaining inflationary increases, you would have been at $35 million. So it would have been $6 million more than what you started at in 2007. Where are we really? Right now, because of the decline in property values, you ended the year with property tax revenue of $21 million. So that's $14 million less than what we would have anticipated. Again, if I was putting together a long-term plan for you in 2007, we would have predicted inflationary increases in property tax revenue. That's $14 million a year less revenue than what would have been predicted if it had been if a five-year plan had been put together for you back in 2008. And as you can see, it completely wiped out any benefit that you received from the five mills that that your voters so graciously approved back in, I believe it was 2008. So you're well below that level right now. And then one more quick property tax graph. You know, the two terms that get discussed a lot relative to Proposal A when it comes to property taxes are taxable value and SEV. Most of us can remember the day when property taxes were based off of SEV, state equalized value. Proposal A came along and said, you know, we're going to lock in whatever number you were at for your SEV, and then we're going to have a new concept called taxable value. And your tax dollars that you pay as residents are going to be based upon taxable value, which is disconnected then from SEV and can only go up by the lesser of inflation or 5%. So the reason the top bar, which is SEV, is higher than the bottom bar, which is taxable value, is because there were years when property values were going up greater than inflation, but your tax revenue was generated off the taxable value. The real problem hit in 2011 when we reached the point when taxable value essentially equated out to SEV. So there was a buffer there that was protecting communities from suffering significant decreases in property tax revenue during 2008, when the property values first began declining. That buffer is completely gone now. So if SEV goes down, taxable value goes down, dollar for dollar, percent for percent. And so in terms of those numbers, between 2011 and 2012, the decline in taxable value was 13%. And no one knows for certain what next year is going to hold, although it was mentioned to me prior to the meeting, and I believe that this to be true, that Macomb County collectively is predicting a 6% decline in taxable value, at least that's what I heard. And the thought process, it would be that Roseville might be lagging that to some extent, just because of the makeup of the community. So you should be thinking somewhere probably in the 6 to 9 to 10% range in terms of a decline in taxable value for the upcoming year. And of course, your assessor can give you more details on that. We are hoping for Roseville, as for all of our communities, that things are starting to level out. But time will tell. One last slide for you that, again, this is fund balance related. What we have here is a summary of the general fund's fund balance. I don't think it's necessary to get into the details. I think just watching what happens to those bars moving from left to right says it all. The total bar, like in 2008, that total bar would have totaled up to $13.3 million. That was your June 30th, 2008 fund balance level in the general fund. The 2012 bar totals up to $4.3 million. So that's a $9 million decrease since 2008 in the general fund's fund balance. And if you look at it, it's almost a consistent step down year after year after year after year. So that's the structural deficit that Kathleen was referring to. You have been doing your best to make certain that structural deficit doesn't get any worse, because property taxes have been going down. You've been cutting expenditures to keep up with those declines. But at least as of the end of your current fiscal year, that structural deficit was still there. And again, this is a phenomenon that every mature community within Michigan, not just Macomb County, is having to deal with and work through. The last item that I wanted to bring your attention to is actually in that separate letter. There's one more letter from Plant Moran that's dated December 13th, 2012. It's got my signature on the bottom of it, if you see that. That's my real signature, so don't use it for checks. If you turned into page 6, because we so oftentimes get asked, how is our community doing? Because, Plant Moran, you audit a lot of communities. Mark and Kathleen, you work with a lot of communities. What do you see about our community relative to others? What I would point out here is that for 2012, this is just from my own perspective, that there were some significant financial highlights. The council did make some very significant reductions. You can see the first four bullet points in the middle of that page. You settled for the city's contracts, which gained a 15% reduction in total personnel costs, which is obviously very significant. I know that you still have some of the police contracts that have not been completely settled yet. As you saw, your public safety expenditures are 50% of your general fund balance. So hopefully you'll have similar results on those contracts as well. That would help. You made some structural changes to your prescription drug program. You were able to get the voters of your community to get behind a separate millage for Parks and Rec and Library. Extremely important. Had you not done that, those would have been two very valuable services to your residents, which most likely would have had to have been either significantly reduced or eliminated in the long run. So now you've helped put in path the long-term stability for those. And you've reduced 30 overall personnel during the past year, which is a very significant cut as well. So those are all very meaningful, very significant accomplishments. As you look forward, the items that we have then are listed on the next set of bullet points, things to consider going forward. Again, of course, hopefully achieving the resolution that you need on your open contracts, continuing to monitor your health care and your legacy costs, and doing everything you can to reduce those costs is going to be important. Even though I'm an outside vendor, I would tell you achieving reductions in the cost of any outside vendor that you have, I would focus on outside vendors who have contracts that are greater than 100 grand. Ours is not greater than 100 grand, but you can still focus on us too. I mean, you should be looking across the board at everybody. And then, again, just placing a high emphasis on maintaining that remaining fund balance that you have, because really, you've reached the point right now in your general fund where you really cannot go any lower fund balance-wise. So whatever it takes, you got to maintain that fund balance, and that, you know, I'm certain is the position council's already looking at taking. With that, sorry it was a little bit longer-winded than I had promised, but Mayor, I'd like to open it up to you and council for any questions or comments.
Are there any questions for Mr. Hurst this evening?
I think we've seen it many times.
I guess, Mr. Hurst, there's one thing, and every year we ask you about your report, and it equals out to like a AAA bond rating. Is that a fair statement that we're in good shape as far as, except for our fund balance shrinking?
Yeah, and so it's a great question, Mayor. I mean, the main reason that we're brought in isn't to make an assessment on your overall financial condition, although I kind of just did that a little bit. The main reason we're brought in is to kick the tires on your books and records and your internal controls and make certain that those are where they should be. And I would say you're an A-plus community in that respect. And I mean A-plus and from a school perspective, not a bond rating perspective. And again, can't give enough credit, and I know she hates it when I do this, so she's probably walking out right now, but to Jane Dancy and Bob Cady, but you know, Jane in particular, for all the care and time that she puts into making certain that the records are literally dollar perfect. So.
I guess the last question I have is, tonight we're going to talk about one of the police contracts, and if they've met their number of 15%, on top of what you just done, if we get another 15% for them, then that would even make us in a better position than not to eat into our fund balance.
Yeah, I do know that you've been working very hard to settle those contracts and gain every possible concession that you can get. 15% won't hurt. There's no question about that. That's going to help. So anything that you can get is important. 15% on the surface sounds, you know, like a good number. I would layer on top of that, of course, there's still a tremendous amount of uncertainty. You know, every day we wake up, I mean, we were, you know, out here on, I think it was Friday of last week, we had a meeting with the city manager and with Bob, and at that very, we were watching the changes happening in Lansing with respect to personal property tax live, and it was just the most ridiculous thing to follow, to be honest with you. And nobody even really knows what the ultimate dollar impact of that's going to be. So still a lot of uncertainty, but, you know, a 15% reduction is obviously significant, so that will help, no doubt.
And since you brought it up, since the legislation has done away with our personal property tax, it's going to hurt all the communities in Michigan, I'm assuming. Is that what your perspective would be?
Yeah, there's no question that it will hurt every community. The one thing that I will point out, they are reducing it. Hasn't been completely eliminated yet, but we've all been there before. It's a slippery slope. You know, you take that first step and it gets cut. So there are a lot of people that are thinking that this is the first step towards elimination. I certainly hope that's not the case, because that's another $2 million a year, Mr. Cady? $2.2 million a year in revenue for the city of Roseville. So something's got to give. And I certainly hope
that,
it's not
would be
elimination.
Assumed in our next report, though, if that does happen.
Yes,
it doesn't have anything to do with this. Okay. Any other questions? Mr. Hurst, thank you very much. Thank you, lady, for coming up tonight to give us
council,
a report.
Have a happy holidays.
Okay. Does anybody have any more questions for Mr. Adkins then? Or Mr. Cady or Ms. Dancy then? Ms. Dancy, Mr. Cady, Mr. Adkins, very good job on helping Plant Moran do our audit. I'm glad our numbers are still in a positive manner, so my hat's off to you guys. You did a fine job. Thank you very much. With that, I'll have a motion to accept the audit report.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Iuto, supported by Councilwoman McCartney. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Next item is request adoption of resolution authorizing the City of Roseville Fire Department, Fire Marshal Division, to conduct inspections of all retail sale fireworks location, permanent and temporary. Mr. Adkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council, as we recently had discussed at one of our previous meetings, new legislation has been introduced and enrolled that will now allow for a provision for our local fire inspectors and fire marshals to conduct a certain amount of inspections within the city. As we outlined previously, there were certain steps that we had to take by completing a checklist and sending in some documentation, and we've also been informed that a formal resolution is required, will need to be submitted within the next couple of days to the State of Michigan Fire Marshals Division. So you have a copy of a resolution in front of you this evening that would authorize the City of Roseville Fire Department Fire Marshal Division to conduct inspections of fireworks at retail sales locations. I would ask for your consideration in approving the resolution.
Are there any questions for Mr. Atkins regarding this matter? Seeing none, I have a motion.
May I make the motion to approve the request as presented?
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman McCartney to adopt the resolution as presented, supported by Councilman Shoemaker. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next item is request approval to enter into agreement for Macomb County Animal Shelter Services. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council, you have before you this evening a draft agreement for Macomb County Animal Shelter Services. As you recall, we've been using the services for the past several years. The agreement remains largely unchanged with the exception of some fee adjustments. Those to be pointed out for you, the charges for each pet or animal requiring a 10-day quarantine is increased by $3 from $150 to $153. Cost for repairing and transporting rabies specimens from $65 to $66. And requiring the use of tranquilizer equipment from $80 to $82. So nominal changes, the structure of the agreement remains the same. It has been reviewed by the city attorney and would request your consideration and approval of the agreement this evening.
Are there any questions for Mr. Atkins regarding this matter? Seeing none, what are the wishes of the council?
Mayor, I move to approve the request approving the agreement with Macomb County Animal Shelter Services.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Shoemaker to enter into an agreement with Macomb County, supported by Councilman Ayuto. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request closed door session to discuss union negotiations. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, we have a couple of items we'd like to discuss with you in a closed door session this evening for purposes of the union negotiations. We do expect that there may be some action after one of the items, at least by council, to take. So we ask for your consideration to go into a closed door session for that purpose.
Okay, can I get a motion to go in a closed door then, please?
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilman McCartney, supported by Councilman Ayuto. Mr. Clerk, roll call vote.
Councilman Satulski is absent. Councilman Shoemaker?
Yes.
Councilwoman McCartney?
Yes.
Councilman Haggerty is absent. Councilman Ayuto?
Yes.
Councilman Mayor Pro Tem Taylor is absent. Mayor Turkin?
Yes.
Four positive votes, Mayor. Motion carried.
Okay, we will go in a closed door session now because we have to come back out and consider the ratification of the Police Officers Association of Michigan agreement and the rest of the city business. So we will go in a closed door at this time. At a closed door session for contract negotiations, it is December 18, 2012 at 8:39 p.m. The next item is council consideration of ratification of the Police Officers Association of Michigan agreement. Mr. Atkins.
Yes, Mayor, members of council, I would ask for consideration of the council for ratification of the Police Officers Association of Michigan agreement as discussed with council with an effective date of December 24th, 2012.
Are there any questions for Mr. Atkins regarding the Police Officers Association Michigan agreement? Mr. Atkins, this accomplishes for them what we wanted to do overall with all the rest of the unions. Am I correct in this?
Yes, it does. It's in line with the request from council. It achieves the minimum of 15% of cost savings to the city, also permanent structural change, specifically in the areas of health care and retirement or pension related issues. So it does fall in line with the direction as set by council.
Okay. Are there any other questions? Councilman Ayuto.
Do we need to read publicly the summary of that contract, or is that not required by law?
Not required.
Not required?
That's correct. It's not required.
Thank you.
Mayor, if I may, again.
Go ahead.
Without citing the specifics, I mean, it does achieve a number of items that we have addressed from the beginning of this process, which again, under the permanent structural change, will be a benefit for long-term. Specifically, I do want to note that the agreement for a two-tier separation of new hires in the future is very significant for the city. So with that said, it does have some very strong and significant pieces that are beyond the minimum of what council set for direction with percentages and permanent structural change. So it is a move forward or a future contract as well. That's, I believe, a good foundation for where we go from here. And potentially, it could have an impact of 25% of your patrol staff being in the new two-tier level as they're hired in. That is significant.
Okay, and if we do approve this contract this evening, when will we start hiring new people?
That process is underway at this time. They are working through the eligibility list. Obviously, since that list started, and I defer to the clerk for more specifics, we have a number of people who are no longer available or interested in the position, so we do have to do some revisions to that list. But we are working on qualifying the candidates for hiring, and as soon as we have the eligibility list and able to move forward, we certainly will do that. It's our hope that right after the first of the year, we'll be able to do that. Defer to Mr. Steenland.
We do have oral interviews set up for the first week of January, I do believe. We're looking to interview approximately 21 individuals. We have approximately 26 on the list currently. As city manager indicated, the list is about a year and a half old. A lot of people have either got jobs, moved on, or no longer interested in the position. At this point, it looks like we should have hopefully about 15 to 20 we will be interviewing. And again, that list expires in June. So we will be renewing the process in early June. It does look like at this point we should have enough candidates, hopefully, to fill the positions they're looking to fill with the current list, we're hoping.
Okay. All right, any other questions? Seeing none, I would like to acknowledge the president of the RPOA and Mr. Thomason, Mr. Lang, and Mr. Atkins, and Mr. Cady, and for their hard work and diligence into trying to put this contract together. It's not hard to do a concessionary contract, and I know that both sides worked hard to come up with an agreement to come up to save the city the amount of money for the taxpayers and still keep our police services at A1 quality that we have. With that said, I will entertain a motion to approve the contract.
Mayor, I move to approve the ratification of the Police Officers Association of Michigan agreement with an effective date of 12/24/2012.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Shoemaker to ratify the POAM's Roseville Police Officers Association agreement, supported by Councilwoman McCartney. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. It has been ratified. Next item is appointments. I have none this evening, and so reports of city manager.
Yes, Mayor, council members, I have a few items for you this evening. At the last meeting, Councilmember Ayudo had mentioned the casual day donations that were gathered by city employees. We have a little more detail, and I believe we have forwarded this to you in the council packet, but Roseville employees collected $5,590 through casual days to help 12 local organizations or foundations in the community. In addition, with the Salvation Army Angel Tree program that's going on for this holiday season, an additional 80 gifts, approximately $20 each, were donated by employees of the city. So it brings the contributions over $7,000 for 2012. So we appreciate all of the efforts of the employees here at the city to help out our local organizations and families and children in need at this time. Also, a reminder, city offices will be closed on Monday, December 24th and Tuesday, December 25th. Also on Monday, December 31st and Tuesday, January 1st. Waste management will collect regular refuse and recycling on Monday, December 24th and on the 31st. The remainder of the week during both weeks' collection will be one day behind. Also, I would like to thank our state representative, Harold Haw, for his efforts in the personal property tax reform. As the mayor and I know, because we were both up late that evening watching online the actions in Lansing and texting and communicating back and forth, Representative Haw certainly stood up with his past experience as being a local elected official and mayor and stating the significant impact that complete elimination of this tax would have on municipalities. I would like to note that really only Representative Haugh and also Representative Vicky Barnett, who's a former mayor of Farmington Hills, were the only two to really stand up and fight for local municipalities, and I certainly appreciate Harold's efforts as well as Vicky's efforts in speaking forward. And I do think that it made a difference, especially when it came to the amendments that later hit the floor on this issue. Michigan Municipal League earlier today held a telephone conference in regards to the impact on this, and as I've shared with council, and will provide more details as they're available, it does look like the first stages of this will not be upon us until December 31st of 2013, and will affect us in the 2014 year, and there will be a statewide issue on the ballot in August of 2014. So we're yet to see where this will finally end at the complete resolution here, but we'll keep you posted as we go through. But we have received a reprieve. Initially, we thought this was going to have an immediate effect and would be devastating, potentially a loss of over $2 million to the city. And then the last item that I have is, as we all have been consumed since last Friday with the events that have taken place in Newton, Newtown, Connecticut, there are a lot of questions that we've been receiving here about if there's any local efforts or local things that are happening. Certainly, we all take a moment at this holiday season and look at everything and reflect quite differently. But for those that may be interested in sending some type of condolences along, the post office in Newtown, Connecticut has established a special post office box to receive written condolences and notes of sympathy. That is the Newtown, Connecticut Post Office, P.O. Box 3700, Newtown, Connecticut 06470. And we'll put information on our city website for those that are interested in sharing notes at this time of loss in Connecticut. That's all I have for the mayor and council, other than happy holidays for everyone.
Thank you. Are there any questions for Mr. Atkins this evening? Seeing none, we'll move into city attorney's report.
Thank you, Mayor. Nothing legal to report this evening. Just like to wish everyone and the residents a very Merry Christmas.
Thank you. Is there any questions for Mr. Thomason this evening? Seeing none, we move into the second hearing of the public. Second hearing of the public will be for any city business. You're welcome to direct questions, input information, and express opinions to the council. Anyone using inappropriate language will be called out of order, and please limit your remarks to 3 minutes. Anybody from the public wish to be heard this evening? Yes, sir.
Yes, I'm Dave Chesney, 30440 Normal. I just want to thank the council and the city manager and everybody here at City Hall for doing a spectacular job on the budget. You know, considering that property values have dropped off, and then the stuff that Lansing is pulling, you know, Snyder, people voted down the emergency manager law, but what does he and they do up there? They quickly sneak in something like this to reinstate it on a lame duck, you know. You know, Lansing has been very unfair to municipalities. You know, the revenue, they should have more revenue sharing. But when it comes to cutting a municipality like Roseville, you know, and like any other city, you can only cut so much. You gotta have police, you gotta have fire, you gotta have garbage pickup, you gotta have street lights lit, you gotta have a DPW force that, you know, plows the streets and maintains the potholes, and you know, so you know, when you talk about cuts, there's only so much you can cut. I would assume I'm right. You know, if it's 10%, 15%, you can only make, you know, with contract negotiations, you can only cut so much. I personally would like to come and work for the city of Roseville. I work for the city of Detroit. I got 26 years, and the way they're treating us and what they got proposed for us in January, trust me, I want to bail. I want to bail out bad, but I'm going to stick it out and grin and bear it and take what I can, what I have to. But I personally would like to work for the city of Roseville if I could one day. Maybe I will. I'll try. You know, but that's basically what it's all about. You know, you just cannot keep cutting. There's got to be a bottom-out point. And you know, like I said in October, like I said, with the rapid deterioration of Northeast Detroit going the way it is, it definitely is going to have an impact on the neighboring cities. So we have to make the right decisions to keep things going good. And when Waste Management's contract comes up in 2013, you might want to consider going with Rizzo. A number of municipalities have dropped Waste Management for certain reasons. So, you know, you might want to give them a consideration. But you ain't going to get any cheaper when it comes to picking up trash. You know, the cost of what you're paying now, you're not going to get it done any cheaper because companies have to operate. But you might want to consider Rizzo if they get the right bid. And I just want to say, I don't believe in saying happy holidays. I'm a Christian, and I stand for my belief, and I say Merry Christmas, and have a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else in the public wish to be heard this evening? Seeing none, we're going to items for discussion by City Council. Councilman Ayudo.
Thank you, Mayor. I just wanted to thank Jane, Bob, and all the administration for the continued diligence throughout the year to keep our books clean and complete, and for the clean audit that we just received. So, Bob, you're still here. Thank you very much. Generally, to the people, you know, people sometimes ask me, why don't we ask questions during televised meetings? And actually, we have study sessions on, not on camera, but on the, and they are open to the public, on the off Tuesdays that were not televised. We hash out our questions and differences at that time, so that while you watch us here on television, we hold this business meeting and take care of the city's business without wasting your time while watching us. It is my intention to continue to have professional meetings and a council that you can be proud of. That's why you elected us. That's why we talk to each other. We hash it out. But you don't need to see that kind of discussion. And if you wanted to, you're more than welcome to come to the conference room, the city manager's conference room on the off Tuesday. And that's where we take care of the business. This is where we take care of the professional side of the business. So, Merry Christmas to everybody. Happy birthday to my bride. And may 2013 be a better year for all of you and us. God bless and take care of each other. That's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you, Councilman Ayudo. Councilman Shoemaker.
That means happy birthday, Beth. That's correct.
Happy birthday, Beth.
Absolutely. Jane and Bob, thanks for the work you do on the books. The audit report was near perfect. I guess a half a journal entry was off, and that's incredible. So great job on that. Today at noon at Sacred Heart Church, Father Ventline had a prayer service for the victims in Connecticut, and just continue prayers and ask for God's peace for the victims and their family, for the victims' family and friends out there in Connecticut. And I'd like to wish everybody a Merry Christmas. That's all I have, Mayor.
Thank you. Councilwoman McCartney.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to thank the clerk for giving us this calendar and offering that to the public. So thank you, Mr. Clerk, for that. To Mark Hurst and Kathleen from Plant and Moran, thank you for your hard work. Bob, Katie, obviously you, and for Jane for all your hard work. Appreciate that. And to the bargaining units for the RPOA, Mr. Adkins, Mr. Lang, thank you for all your hard work. This means a lot. I have a get well wish for Mr. Clement and a speedy recovery. And because of the tragedy in Connecticut, I'd like to say to Roseville, go home, hug your kids, hug your loved ones. If you plan on having any type of cheer over the holiday, please drink responsibly. And a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And that's all I have.
Thank you. I don't have very much to say this evening, but Mr. Chesney, when you were up talking about the budget, Roseville's got about as lean and mean as we can. We've kept our services up. We've reduced our budget. You've seen by the auditors today how much money we saved. We still have a fund balance, which is good, and we'll knock on wood that it stays that way. Unfortunately, the things that are going on in Lansing, yes, they can affect us. Maybe they won't affect us right away, but they will in the future. And unless they're heard by the other mayors throughout the state of Michigan. I know myself, for one, I've contacted the representatives, even Republican representatives and senators, to tell them not to mess with our personal property tax. I do not like shifting the burden of taxes to our homeowners and residents when the businesses are in the business to make money. And to get that business to stay here, I think most businesses are doing well and everything's leveled out. So for them to do that to our residents, I think is very unfair for them to make us stand up and go into our pocketbooks more. It's like I said, you know, I've said this time and time again, the governor has taxed everybody's pensions now. We've seen some EVIT money come back, but we'd sure like to see a lot more. I don't know what he's doing with that, unless he's subsidizing businesses with it, but I don't know what the governor's doing with it. And that's something I'll take up with our state representative, because I'm sure he'll be able to tell us. But I would like to thank Harold. He did get up on the floor in the House and talk about all the cities in Macomb County, especially Roseville, about what we're facing. And through his efforts and through the Michigan Municipal Leagues, they have changed some of their philosophy, and they've put some new amendments in. Like Councilwoman McCarthy said, the tragedy that happened in New England, no one wants to see that happen. I know our police chief has been in contact with our schools to make sure that our schools are the safest in Michigan. But with that said, I would like to tell everybody in the city of Roseville to please have a Merry Christmas and have a safe, blessed New Year's. And with that, a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Motion by Councilman Ayudo, supported by Councilman Shoemaker. All in favor?